little bit short today because Wednesday's things, we had to wait to find out what kind of CRISPR things you're interested in. So that's going to come out on Wednesday. But this week we're going to, actually it's all going to be transgenics. It's just we're going to be moving from transgenics in the way that we've been making them before to sort of the newest ways that people are making transgenic organisms. And we'll talk a lot about CRISPR editing today, kind of the basics of where it comes from, which is actually, I think, really interesting. And then how people are customizing this to be able to do very precise editing. We call it genome editing, and I'll explain that in a little bit. So I want to kind of back up and say, we've been talking for the last week about transgenic organisms, and one of the big things, or maybe there are many things you can do for them. For this class, what are the things that we're focused on? So this is going to be a little bit of a review of the things that we covered, but also to give you an idea of what are the things that we think are most important for you to know how to do. And if you look at what's in the problem set, and we'll release last year's exam in a little bit, you'll see what we're really focused on. It's not the technical details of how you make these, but why you want to make them. What do we do with transgenic organisms, and what are the sort of building blocks? What are the pieces that you want to put together to answer interesting biology? So what can we do with them? So I mentioned last week, essentially there's three different things that we're going to focus on. One is that we're always adding foreign DNA, but in the very first episode of this, it was we're going to add in DNA, and it's going to go anywhere. And all of this as an example, we use mice as an example. There's lots of different organisms that you can put foreign DNA into, but to just kind of keep it straightforward and on one track, we're just going to talk about this in mice. So when we added foreign DNA, there were really two sorts of things that we were trying to do. So in one case, we were trying to complement a recessive mutation. So we thought we had identified mutation in the gene that made it lose its function. We wanted to be sure of that. And the best way to be sure of that is to provide the wild type normal DNA. And if we restore, if we put that back in the mouse, and the mouse is complemented, it's back to normal, then we know that we've identified the right piece of DNA. So we can complement a recessive mutant. And to do this, what we were creating, and this is what we want you to be able to do, is say we're going to create something that has a regulatory region for your gene of interest. You need the coding region of the wild type coding region. And then in order for this to actually work, and in order for us to know that this DNA got into the mouse, somewhere in this chunk of DNA that we were creating, so we've engineered this whole piece, was our marker. And in this case, we keep using this NeoRNA. And I'll come back to NeoRNA in a little bit more detail. Okay, so we can complement something. The other thing that we wanted to do was find out where is a gene normally transcribed. So all of your cells have the same DNA, not all of them make this. Yeah, they all have the same DNA, not all of them make the same RNA, not all of them make the same proteins. So in regulatory regions, there are some that are only active in the eye or only active under stress. So how do we figure that out? So we can make a reporter. And a reporter of where is a gene transcribed. Where do we make RNA from that? And I'll often say, where is it active? Kind of synonymous. And for that, we would need a regulatory region of a gene that we're trying to test. And then we would have DNA to encode something like green fluorescent protein, something that we can see. And of course, we need to have that are in there just so we can follow that DNA. Now we might want to have a reporter of where the protein of that gene is also. Where is it in the cell? Where is it made? And so we can ask where is a gene transcribed plus where is the protein. have our regulatory region, we'll have our GFP, we need our coding region of that gene, and then we've got our NAOR. Okay, so those are all the parts that you would need to add. And this is the kind of thing that we're going to ask you. We're say, if you, someone tells you that they think that this gene is only expressed in the eye, tell us what you would need to be able to say whether or not that's true. Okay, so you say, well, if I think the gene is expressed in the eye, I'm going to take the regulatory region of that gene, I'm going to make take that and combine it with something like GFP that I can see, make sure I can get it into my mouse, I'm going to have a marker, a selective marker like NAOR, and that's what I'm going to put together. Okay, so that's adding in foreign DNA, and at this point, we weren't really worried. This is actually so foreign, you know, there's no GFP normally in a mouse. And so we weren't trying to target it to a particular part in a chromosome. We weren't going to target a gene. But then we got a little more sophisticated and say, well, what if we do want to do that? What if we want to take the normal gene and replace it? And we might want to replace it with a gene that's no longer active, and that lets us test what is the role of that gene. We might want to change the gene into something, so this is a knockout. The idea would be we'd eliminate the function of that gene. That's a very common thing that we do. And the other is that maybe we don't want to be so blunt about it. We don't want to completely eliminate that gene. We might want to make a subtle version where a single base is changed, or a few bases are changed, and it looks like an amino acid change that we've seen associated with the disease. Okay, so this is replacing or targeting where we want to do something where we're specifically going to change one region of the chromosome, not just drop it in anywhere. And so what do we have to do for this one? We need this additional thing, so we need those, we need to target it to a certain sequence, so we need to have something that's homologous to it. So this is where those that concept of homology arms came up. So sequences on the side of what you wanted to put in that were identical DNA sequence to where you wanted it to go. Source of confusion. And then what we'll talk about today that's new is that it's another sophistication of that, which is we're going to target, so this is going to target and replace the gene, and we're going to do this in the embryo, and we're going to do it so every single cell has a targeted gene. We're going to eliminate the function of that gene or change the function of that gene in every single cell. But it's equally important, it's very important to be able to inactivate a gene just in some cells. And so there's a cool trick to be able to do that, and I'll get into that a little bit more. So because this was definitely a challenge in my explanations, and people had a lot of questions at the TA office hours about this NAOR thing, so I wanted to just go back over and talk about this. So whenever we're targeting a gene, again, so NAOR is just this thing that lets us know DNA got in there. We've used the fact that this is a foreign piece of DNA, not normally in a gene. If we replace part of a normal functioning active gene with any random piece of DNA, our normal functioning gene is not going to be so normal anymore. It's going to have something else in it. And if we engineer this in such a way where there's a stop codon at the end of it, our gene isn't going to get made. So we can disrupt, if we want to inactivate a gene, we can use this as a way of targeting it. If we don't want to completely disrupt the function of a gene, we want the gene to work pretty normally, maybe have one little change in it, we still have to somehow incorporate this, because this incorporation of this little green guy here allows us to see that DNA got into these cells, into these mice. So we've got to put it somewhere. this is going to destroy our gene. But genes that have introns in them, it's the normal way that, that those are processed, those introns are taken out of what becomes the final protein. And so this gives us a little safe haven where we can put things like this so that they still let us know that DNA got in there, but they're not actually going to disturb the function of this gene. Okay. So one of the things that a lot of people were then asking was, okay, I'm really confused about, so NEOR, so what is that? And it's got, if you remember, we draw this out. It has a regulatory region, and I said it was ubiquitous, so it turns on all the time. And then we have, so this would be the DNA here. So it's coding for something that says turn on all the time. And then we have the resistance. This is going to make an RNA and then eventually a protein that when we add a drug, this is going to make any cell that makes this protein is going to be resistant to that drug. And then there's a little bit just on either end because there always is. But one of the other things is that, so when we make this, so when the cell makes this, it's going to use that regulatory region that's going to make RNA that corresponds to this. That RNA is going to eventually be made into protein. And that protein will provide resistance. Now at the end, so we're going to encode in here, though, a stop codon. So that means the protein stops when it should. The thing is that with that stop codon is here, so that gene is going to make an RNA, and when that RNA is going to be translated, it's going to run into a stop. So let me try to, so that's what that little region is. But let me also try to go back to something that took me a while, actually, to kind of figure out how it is that you could drop that NEOR into something. So some of you were really still upset by, if I put this thing into an intron, introns get cut out. How is it possible that this thing still works? And what I wanted to maybe take a step back and say, okay, so let's imagine the nucleus of a cell. So in there, there's chromosomes, DNA. Let's take an RNA polymerase view of this. View of this cell. So RNA polymerase, this is the thing that's going to make RNA. Okay, when it is looking in the nucleus, looking at the chromosomes, what RNA polymerase sees is, so this is the way that I'm going to indicate that's a promoter region or a the beginning of a regulatory region. That's the place where RNA polymerase will actually sit down and start transcribing. What RNA polymerase sees when it looks at chromosomes is little things like this. It sees places where it should go and start transcribing RNA. It has no idea what if that RNA is going to be processed. It has no idea what the protein is. All this RNA polymerase sees are places for it to land and to start transcribing. And so RNA polymerase is going to be this little red guy, and our RNA is going to look like this. Then RNA polymerase is going to say, oh, I should start here, and I should make some RNA going off in this direction, so I should make some RNA that's similar to the DNA sequence over here. Okay, so I should land here, make some RNA. Maybe I should make a lot of RNA, or maybe just a little bit. Okay, and sometimes it means that it's going to make RNA go in this direction, but sometimes it's going to reach the other direction and it's going to make RNA that looks like this, go in the opposite direction. You guys okay with that? some no's. So, RNA polymerase can only do one thing, recognize a piece of DNA and copy it. So no matter where all it's doing is finding this place, wherever, and copying RNA that's in a particular direction relative to it. So RNA can read DNA, DNA is double-stranded, it can read in this direction, it can read in this direction. You don't need to know how it reads it, but it can read it. Okay, so this is what RNA polymerase sees. So now, let's zoom in to this chromosome. And say, okay, let me rewrite that. Polymerase says, I should start making RNA here, start making some RNA here, so this is your double-stranded DNA here. Oh, got a little twisted. So we'll make some RNA that's equivalent to this section here, but let's make it longer. Again, this is going this way. Thanks. And if we look at the sequence of this, it's going to be complementary to the DNA down here. Okay, so if there was a here, this is actually being read off the other strand, so there'd be an A here. If there's a T here, there'd be a U here, because it uses a slightly different thing. Okay. So RNA polymerase does not know where an intron boundary is or where an exon boundary is or anything like that. Just knows I should start and I should make RNA. So what we've been showing you is a gene where we said, here's one gene. This is our regulatory region of our gene. Imagine this is an exon in here. This gene, and here's another exon. Okay? And this, for this one gene that we're looking at, happens to be an intron. Okay? So we'll get rid of everything else. Just focus on this one gene. One gene has a regulatory region, it has a couple of exons, and it has a couple of introns. So when we're looking at it, we're saying this gene has an intron, but when RNA polymerase looks at it, all it says is somewhere in this, okay, you said there's an intron. I don't care. All I see is that there's something where I'm supposed to land and make RNA. So we're taking advantage of that, because if we zoomed in on this, what I'm going to tell you is that that little NeoR cassette, that's here. So we can make our little NeoR just a chunk of DNA. It's got a regulatory region and it's got a coding region. We can even put it in upside down. Okay, that doesn't look like anything new, but it says NeoR going that way. Okay, so this is a chunk of DNA we've engineered. But RNA polymerase doesn't doesn't know anything about introns or exons. It just says, okay, I see this little arrow. It means I'm going to make RNA. This is how we can put something in that when we're looking at the DNA level, it's perfectly happy to make RNA from it. Now this gene, if we think about it, so we're reading the regular gene this way, follow the RNA all the way. It's going to be making RNA all the way through here. Again, RNA polymerase doesn't know where an intron or exon is. It just knows where to start, and it has some signal to tell it where to stop. Later, so this is our original RNA. Later, this is going to get processed. So that area where the intron is, that's going to get cut out. And so we're just going to join that first bit. So. The last bit. So at this point, you cut everything out here, but it didn't eliminate the ability of this thing to make its own RNA. So we're going to cut that out, and then that is going to be made into protein. Okay, so that's sort of the whole, I think those were some of the questions that were coming up was, how is this possible to still work in an intron? And the reason is that this is happening independent of RNA being made in the first place. Okay? So, questions on that? Yeah?
What determines whether you add the new RNA to an intron?
Okay, so now we're getting back to the biology of this. What determines whether we're going to add this little thing to the intron or the exon? We put it in the intron, still works to let us be resistant, but it's not going to interrupt this gene, right? So that's what's going on here. This gene, it's going to make its RNA perfectly fine. It's just going to, it's going to cut this chunk out. It's not going to disrupt it. This is a way that we can manipulate some other things about that DNA. If you stick it in the exon, if something's in the middle of the exon, it doesn't get cut out like that. So if we'd stuck it here, in part A, all of part A is made into RNA, all of part A, it would have this extra chunk of RNA in there that would make that inactive. Yep?
Is it possible that you have a protein that's fully functional because the segment transcribed by the first exon and the second exon are directly side by side, and that if you interrupted those two, the POR sequence and the intron right in the middle, that
so it is possible. So intron, like the cell needs to know that this needs to be cut out precisely.
Yeah.
It is possible that if you put something in here, it means that the cell can't read that and can't do the splicing correctly, and that will cause a problem. But typically, I mean, we don't know why cells do this kind of strange thing of putting the useful parts of what's going to be made into a protein in little, you know, interrupting it,
yeah.
But they do it. So the only way that we interrupt that is if we happen to have stuck something in here that sometimes the cell thinks, oh, maybe we put some sequences in here that they mistake and try to use as an exon.
So never interfere with the functionality of the protein that those chunks transcribed by the two exons aren't continuous?
So no.
Okay.
Yeah. Weird, but true. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm a bit confused. So I understand that if you put it in the intron, you can still get new R, but how do you get your modification into the exon? Because isn't that the coding region where you're trying to get the protein, but you're putting it in the intron, so the exon's still the same?
Yeah, so the other part of that was that when we created something, I'll do this on here on the board. So that's a very, very good point. So here the goal would be, we actually want to target something here, right? We want to make a change here.
Right, so you just want to make like a slight change.
You want to make a slight change. So what we're going to create, so this is our DNA on our chromosome. Thank you for asking that question. That's actually the part two that it's good that I actually continue here. What we would create is something that has the change that we want, and we contain this information here, the NEO. And enough information here so that these are those homology arms that recombination could happen here and here. And I'm skipping a step, and don't worry about it for this class. You might say, why do we know that recombination is going to happen here and not here? Don't worry about that for this class. Ask me afterwards if you want to know the details of it. For this class, just know we're going to have something that's similar enough that this can target to the right place. We've got the change that we want to make, and we've got this NEOR somewhere in an intron where it's not going to disrupt anything. That is one thing that is true, yes. But we need to worry about the placement because we need to have it somewhere.
Right.
And if we put it in an exon, that's a problem.
Because it itself has a stop.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So this is a lot of text, and actually the only reason that there's this much text is that so you have it written somewhere. And the kinds of cases that we talked about, so I've actually kind of gone through them already. One of them is making a gene knockout. So here the idea is actually what we just went through. The idea that we're going to knock out the gene by disrupting something important like an exon. We're going to disrupt that by putting a piece of DNA, foreign DNA, into the exon. So if we want to make a knockout, that's what that is, and then that slide is just a text for it, so that you can have a definition of it. And then the other part is a replacement, so that's what we just went through. If you don't want to completely knock something out, you want to replace it, what do we need for that? And then that becomes what I just described in here, where we need to have something that's similar enough to do recombination. We put that NEOR in the intron, and then we've got our change, our subtle change out here. Okay, so the overall scheme for both of those is that we design the DNA that we want, right? So these days we literally say, I want this set of A's and T's and C's and G's, please synthesize it for me, voila, shows up on your doorstep. The things that we are going to need to have in here, there's some part of the gene that's involved, we need those homology arms, and we need to think about where this part goes. Okay, so those are the things you should be thinking about. Yep? So it would be lovely if this was efficient enough that it went in both. So that would be a great thing. It doesn't usually work that well. So that's actually one of the reasons that people are very excited about CRISPR technology, because it actually works very well in both of them. So the goal is yes, but the reality is it usually goes in one. Okay. So you've created this, you've created all of this basically in a test tube or in a bacterium. You've got this piece of DNA into your mouse cells. You did that in culture. You selected for the ones that had the DNA incorporated. You've got that NEOR. And now, hopefully, you've got your DNA in there. So the other thing that people asked about was, if this is our chromosome, and this is the thing that we've added up here, And if homologous recombination works the way that you learned meiosis, then when we've got crossing over, we should be creating two things, right? We should be creating a chromosome where we're crossing over. So let me actually just draw that on here. So our chromosome should have picked up this bit from the thing that we added and incorporated that into the chromosome. And then various students said, well, okay, so the chromosome thing then ends up back in that DNA bit that we made, that they should exchange. So what happens to that? And the thing is that usually it doesn't work that well, but if we create this little engineered piece of DNA, that DNA doesn't have any way of duplicating itself. So every time the cell divides, your chromosomes can duplicate themselves. But this little piece doesn't. And so usually it's just degraded and it gets diluted out. So we don't worry about that anymore because that piece doesn't do anything. But it was a good question. So I put up into files under my name and under lectures some of these figures, so you could go back and look at them. So there's a chapter that I put up and some little excerpts so that you can see these if you want to look at them over on your own. All right, so our third and most sophisticated class of things is something called making a flox allele, okay? And so the purpose of this is this happens a lot, where we think that there's a gene that's important maybe for every single cell. We want to know what it does in just one type of cell or just at one time. Perhaps it's something that's so essential that the embryo would die before we could actually measure anything interesting. So there's a way that all the cells in the body have the gene working normally until we actually inactivate it specifically in certain cells. Okay, and so flox, that comes from blank by loxite. So that probably doesn't tell you very much. A loxite is a sequence of DNA. The reason that we care about it is that it's a sequence of DNA that when there are two of them that are close to each other, there's an enzyme that can recognize those and will actually, so if there are two of them in a row, and there's some DNA in between, an enzyme called a recombinase will bring those two together, and everything in between them is going to be removed. And I'll show you that graphically in a little bit. Okay, so our goal is to inactivate a gene only in a few cells. So how are we going to do this? So this is a really cool system. We're going to need to make two mice, though, okay? So one mouse is going to be engineered with these sequences around our gene. We're going to use this, we're going to do exactly the same things we've just been doing. Just instead of adding a little special allele, we're going to be adding loxites. We need another mouse that's going to express this enzyme that whenever we see these sites, so we're going to have these little sites, we usually represent them like a little arrow. And the reason for that is it's a certain direction, so we've got a sequence in a certain direction. We're going to see that same sequence in the same direction a little bit later on. And what this recombinase does is you've got a DNA molecule, and somewhere in here there are those little sites. So, but these are those two sites. It'll say, oh, I recognize these two. I'm going to take, need a string here. So if it recognizes where my hands are, it's going to recombine those, and everything in between them is going to be deleted. So if you want to eliminate part of the DNA at a certain time, you turn on this enzyme at a certain time, and anything in between these sites is going to be removed. So let's see how that works. So this is what we're going to do. Okay, so these are our two mice. We've got our first mouse. And I told told you, we can put things into introns. This is a safe haven before we put NEOR in there, because we screw up the gene. Here, and for this purposes of this class, don't worry about how we make it, just know this is what you want to make. We're going to put some extra sequences in the intron. This gene, for which there's an exon of it, let's draw the whole gene out. So if we've got the whole gene, got its regulatory region, got some exon, got some intron, got another exon, another exon, another exon, and then the rest of the chromosome there. So what we can do is these sites, we can engineer these into here, and here, and those introns, as far as the RNA polymerase is concerned. So the RNA polymerase is going to make RNA, and it's going to recognize that regulatory region, and it's going to make RNA when the RNA gets processed. We're going to have this part, and then it's going to join. Going to join to some other part, and so, and that's going to be made into protein. So this mouse, everything's normal. Gene works perfectly well. Okay. We have another mouse that expresses Cre recombinase in the eye. So what do we need for this? We need a regulatory region. In the eye, and then this bacterial protein called Cre. Okay. So this is a protein that's normally DNA for a protein that's not normally in mouse, but this is going to do the recombination. How do we know that we've got a regulatory region that is only turned on in the eye? Someone at some point took this sequence of DNA and followed that by GFP. Think about that. At some point, we'll ask you this. This is a nice exam kind of question. Is that at some point someone took this regulatory region and hooked that up to GFP and saw that the eyes glowed? Yep.
In terms of relating kind of the GFP back to what we were talking about earlier with the placement of NEOR, I think there's two options. One, you stick the GFP directly after the promoter, and then the other was like you almost attach the GFP to the end of the protein.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like, though, that attaching it to the end of the protein confers all of the same things that the first one does in terms of making the protein inactive and sticking in like an exon. So why would you ever want to put the GFP right after the promoter? Like why would you only do it so that it attaches on the end of the protein?
Okay, so if we do this, all this is telling us is, so a regulatory region is going to be a tracking RNA polymerase, and those regulatory regions, remember, they've got two major components. They've got the part where RNA polymerase says, okay, this is where I'm going to start making RNA. But they've got that longer bit that says, okay, yes, RNA polymerase, you should show up, but only when the other, this is way back in the beginning of class, you're not going to turn on all the time, right? So there's other, that regulatory region has information that says only be active when these other conditions are met, and those conditions are only met when you happen to be in the eye. So what that means is that a regulatory region, yes, there's RNA polymerase there. But there typically are other proteins there too. And those other proteins allow that to be, so this is a little bit, you'll get this in the Bio-E3 class. There are other proteins that say, yes, just make this go on the eye. Those are proteins that are only made in the eye, and so this will only be active in the eye. Okay, so again, imagine that there's information, we'll tell you there's information in here that allows that to be turned on. So if you just use a regulatory region plus GFP, all that's telling you is, if you have a sequence of DNA here, when does that get turned on? It gets turned on in the eye. It doesn't tell you anything about the protein. It doesn't inactivate or superactivate a protein. It doesn't tell you, this regulatory region, this DNA sequence here, if I put this in front of something else, that something else is, the RNA for that is going to only be made when I'm in the eye.
But if you have, like, you stick the GFP at the end of the protein, wouldn't you also know, like, that exact same information?
You would know that exact same information, plus you would know where the protein was.
Yeah.
So, yes, that's an extra piece of information. Yeah, so that would work as well. This is faster, so more people do this. All right, so these are the two mice that we have. One where our gene that we're interested in, we've engineered these little sites around it. Normally it's working. Here's a mouse that turns on this weird bacterial gene in the eye. That doesn't do anything either. Okay, so we have two mice that are totally, totally normal. Now we cross them together. Okay, so now we have a mouse. That first mouse, where things are working normally, our second mouse that's making that tree, and we're going to look at their progeny, where both of these things are coming together. So we're going to have mice that have these engineered alleles, so a gene has these LOXP sites in it, and that mouse is going to be turning on this enzyme in the eye. So I'm simplifying this because you have to breed a lot to get mice that are homozygous for everything. It's complicated, don't worry about it. But what we want is a mouse that has, for this one gene, it's working normally in most cells. So in most cells, we've got these sites here, but they're in the intron, so that doesn't affect that gene at all. There's no, so this would be most cells, indicating, I guess, it's belly or something. Gene is normal. All the exons are there. There's nothing disturbing it. Things are good. But in those cells that were both, this has happened, and those cells have this enzyme that's made by, so this is that eye-specific regulatory region. So Cre is going to make the RNA and be made into protein. When that protein is there, everything in between these two sites is going to get cut out. It's going to be combined, that little demonstration that I did there, and all of that's going to be removed. So this gets looped out. And you get there. And now you're missing a big chunk of that gene. Now a whole exon is missing, and so that gene is no longer going to work. Okay, so we have a system where you have two normal mice, you cross them together, wait a few generations, and now we can remove the function of a gene in a particular place. Super powerful.
Are we only going to be looking at this orientation of LOXP?
We are only going to be looking at this orientation of LOXP, yes. Yeah. So So for people who have done any kind of engineering, these little sites that we can steal from bacteria can go, so I drew them both in the same direction. You can use them in opposite directions or in multiple ones, and all sorts of crazy things happen. For this class, this is the only one we're going to talk about. Well, so it's actually, the gene is in all of the cells, right? But the information, so this, so not every gene is turned on in every cell. So that we chose a regulatory region so that even though all the, every cell has the DNA, it's only going to be activated in the eye. From the last bit that we talked about is, so from what Professor Pudgeon was talking about, perhaps you start with a gene that you think is really interesting because of a GWAS study or something else, and you've associated a piece of DNA with a phenotype that you're interested in. What do you do next? You need to confirm that that DNA is actually related to that phenotype that you see, and that's what we talked about when we complement, do a molecular complementation of a gene. Do we add back the normal version of that DNA and see that we fix the problem? We can, I mentioned this not so much today, but previously, we can ask where a gene might act by only having it only active in certain cells. We just talked about you can remove it in certain cells, so we can find out where that gene is important. We can make knockout mutants, or we can mimic disease alleles. And then what I just talked about with this system. So those are the kinds of things that we want you to know. What are the, why would you do those things? How would you do them, basic level, and what are the parts? Okay. So that's the key part to this. And then we start to shift gears a little bit. And I think this is kind of what I sometimes talk to with people who are very interested in bioengineering and, you know, why look at genetics. And genetics in a lot of ways is the way things are. Sometimes, like why you have introns and exons is, well, I don't know why, but that's the way it is, right? So genetics is often telling us the way things are. That might not be the most efficient way of doing things, but it does explain the system that we have now. So, and genetics is a way that we start to probe mysteries of the universe, or at least of our own bodies. But sometimes this isn't the way that we want it to be. And so the last bit, we're going to talk a lot more about engineering things, building on all of the different parts that you've just heard over the last 9 weeks. So there are many, many repetitions of us trying to engineer genomes. And it gets more and more and more sophisticated each time. It gets more sophisticated, it gets easier, it's more powerful. 3 years ago, I would have taught something completely different in this section, and now we're going to talk about CRISPR because that's sort of the newest and the latest. So what we're going to talk about is precision genome editing, and I'll define that on the next slide. And we'll do that in two parts. The first part is to tell you about CRISPR and Cas9. What is it? How does it work? Why does it exist in nature? And then we're going to move that into, well, great, that exists. People figured out how to harness it. What are the kinds of things that we're interested in using it for? All right, so what do I mean by genome editing? And part of this is in contrast to previous other things, but let me just define this as a way that we make very precise and also inherited changes to the DNA. So we want to make this precise, inheritable. So what might that be in contrast to? this is because, you know, why do we want to engineer things? It's often because we want better food or better health or something else like that. How did we used to engineer things? We often used to put, so plant breeding is kind of amazing here. We used to take something like a grapefruit and say, that grapefruit, that's okay. It's a little sweet, but not so sweet. Let me put it in front of this nuclear reactor. This is real. Wait till it breaks all the chromosomes. Because citrus fruit doesn't have to actually reproduce, you can graft it. Let's see if I get any sweeter grapefruit out of it with completely broken chromosomes. So completely random mutagenesis. And guess what? Anyone have Rio Star, that lovely ruby red grapefruit? That's how that's made. So we used to randomly mutagenize things and look for stuff that was better. There was nothing precise about it. Get what we wanted by exposing things to toxic radiation or chemicals and saying, hey, they grew an extra arm, that's great, let's keep that one. Okay, so, but it's also, we look for the last couple weeks and talking about something that's fairly precision. CRISPR is easier than that, okay, so easier than other methods. So why is this a powerful approach? Powerful because we can make precision edits and it's fast and cheap and easy, relatively speaking. And it's very customizable. You'll see how we can adapt the system to do lots of different things. So it's powerful. Controversial for those same reasons, that if something is, if any of you in the room could very easily go and engineer something, should you? Should people who aren't in this room be doing that? People will have access to changing genomes of other organisms, potentially themselves, so that leads to all sorts of ethical issues. And that's that last bit, and we'll talk about that more on Wednesday, about some of the issues that come up with the things that people are using CRISPR for. Okay, so if we're going to use, so we're going to talk about genome editing, and this particular way that genome editing works was a thing called CRISPR-Cas. So what does this come from? It's actually the immune system of the bacterium. That's where it originally came from. And these terms, you don't need to know what they stand for. But CRISPR is clustered regularly interspersed short palindromic repeats. You'll see why in a moment. And then Cas is a CRISPR-associated protein. So I guess that's C and AS. So there are actually lots of these CRISPR-associated proteins. There's Cas1, Cas2. The famous one is called Cas9. And that's the one that we'll talk about most. There are more. So this is an immune system. And like our own immune system, so if you think about our own immune system, so we get a virus, right? So a virus infects us and we're a little bit miserable for a while. But then we tend to build a defense against it, right? So bacteria also we have all sorts of things in our blood and bones. Anyway, we've got lots of special ways of our immune system working. Bacteria are not that sophisticated, but still they get viruses that come in. Those viruses try to put put their DNA into the bacterium, and the bacterium can usually kill the bacterium, so the bacterium would like to defend itself against these viruses. So it needs to recognize those viruses, and if those viruses come back, it needs to be able to destroy those viruses. Okay, so what this is a couple of steps where a bacterium is exposed to a virus. It captures the DNA of that virus and puts it in a special place. Integrates that DNA into a special place of the bacterial chromosome. And then the bacterium basically uses the DNA of the virus against itself. So the viral DNA that's been captured becomes a template, so it's going to make RNA based on that viral DNA. And that RNA, if a new virus comes in, that RNA is going to drag some other things we'll hear about in a moment to the new virus and kill it. A new infection with the same virus. So if a virus comes in and it makes RNA against that virus, if a different virus comes in and we can't really defend against that, so that'd be the same virus or similar virus. And then what's going to happen is that new virus, the DNA of that new virus is going to be cut. Graphically, it looks like this. So you've got the virus enters the cell. Well, the virus sits on the outside of the cell and it injects its DNA into the cell. That DNA, and here's just a little green square, that DNA from the virus is going to get into the chromosome of the bacteria. But it goes in a very special place. And there are enzymes called Cas1 and Cas2 that do this. You don't need to know about that. Okay, so this DNA gets captured into the chromosome of bacteria. See these little diamonds? That's a special thing that's made from the bacteria. It's going to use that and make new RNAs that are a hybrid of sequences that it had plus this thing that it captured from the virus. So we're going to get these little RNAs that are half virus and half what was already in the bacteria. Those little things, when a new virus comes in, so it's got a little section derived from the green virus here, that can go recognize if the green virus comes back again. So this little bit, plus some things from the bacteria, are all going to get together, and when they see the new bacteria, they're going to cut it. So the important things about this is there's recognition. So there's a tool that says any DNA sequence made of certain sets of bases, I've got a tool that's going to go find that. And that's that RNA. And that RNA is able to attract other things that will do something to that sequence. So this is a targeting system. You have a piece of DNA that you're interested in changing. This can find it. And depending on how we manipulate this bit and this bit, we can modify something that we want to modify. So I put the next couple of diagrams up in files for you, so if you want to look at them a little bit more in depth, you can do that. So this is on Canvas. This happens to be the page that I put up. So this is a little bit more expanded version of what happens in that bacterium when something gets assembled. I just really like this because it's a cool way. So DNA and RNA, because of those bases, they can find each other. They can form a nice little stable interaction. And that little interaction gives you specificity. You can target any gene you want. And the RNA can also drag along something that can do interesting things. So again, there are three genes that we need to worry about. Two of these that for this defect. So this is one gene, this is the second gene, and this is the third gene region. So these are genes that the bacterium has. So one of these genes makes an RNA, but that RNA doesn't make a protein. So it's functional as an RNA. That's called a tracer RNA. The second gene makes the Cas9 protein, so it's going to make an RNA. That RNA is going to be translated into protein. And then it's got this funny region, which was what I was just explaining. It's got these captured viruses interspersed with some parts that are the same. So the way that the bacterium makes this little defense is it's kind of a wild system. So there's this very, very long RNA. It's made from this region. This very, very long RNA is right here, this long RNA. And that gets cut up into little pieces. How does it get cut up into little pieces? It gets cut up into little pieces because this protein is something that will cut DNA. It'll only cut DNA when it's directed to a particular place. How does it find it? This little RNA here, and this sits inside of this protein. And part of this RNA out here is complementary, has the opposite base pairs of this little black part in here. So they can all assemble together. I would go back and look at this. It's a really cool little system with every part fitting together. And they're gonna cut it into these little bits. So each one of these little bits has a part that recognizes the virus. And there's a part that recognizes Cas9. Well, in this case, it recognizes the RNA that's embedded in Cas9. So when a new virus comes in, virus has its own DNA, and this little machine, that's a cutting machine. And again, I'm going to go through all of these parts separately. This is kind of an overview. This little cutting machine has an RNA stuck in it. That RNA is complementary to one of these RNAs. These RNAs have two parts, one part that's complementary to this little unit, and another part that recognizes the virus. So all together, this can recognize a virus, and when this Cas9 protein is here, this thing here, what that's going to do is it's going to cut the DNA, and then that will be inactive. So people realize that this could be actually useful if we could figure out a way of harnessing it. So this is going to be the overview. Again, I'll go through the different parts. But we're going to be talking about something that can recognize a particular part of DNA. The way that it recognizes it is that there's an RNA in here that has the sequence that's complementary to it. So if there's an A in the DNA sequence, there would be a U in the RNA sequence. So there's a place that it goes, and then this unit is going to cut the DNA. And when it cuts the DNA, there's two possible things that can happen. So if you take one of your chromosomes and you break it in half, the cell is going to recognize that this is a very terrible thing that's just happened. It's terrible to have broken chromosomes. It's going to try to fix that. One thing it might do is just join the ends together. And so this is one thing that we'll talk about, what happens when ends get joined together. The other possibility is something where it's a little bit more precise. We can provide extra information, and when this is broken, it's going to try to fix itself, but it's going to fix itself with the DNA that we provide. And so we can custom build something in here. So we'll go through each one of those things separately. So to engineer, so this is the engineered version. And the kinds of things that we're going to engineer was in the bacterium, you had all this processing of RNAs and adding things together, which is kind of cool, but it's complicated. So what we can actually do is synthesize a single RNA, like literally call up the company and ask to build an RNA, that has the part that's going to recognize whatever you want to target, plus a part that's going to drag along this protein. Okay, so there's a single RNA with one region that closes up to that protein to bring the protein wherever you want it, and another part that's going to recognize the DNA. So this is a single RNA here that did a job too. Cas9 here, because we're often using with working with eukaryotic systems. So this came from a bacteria. Bacterium doesn't have a nucleus. So for this to work for our cells, we need to modify this protein so it goes into the nucleus. So that's a little modification you need to do. Okay, so let's take those things apart. So this single guide RNA I mentioned. You can synthesize a single molecule of RNA, other ways of doing it. But part of that RNA is going to be specific to that target. And the other part, which had used to be the tracer RNA if you were in the bacteria, that other part is just, it's a structurally inside of the Cas9 so that it will bring it to where it goes. So together this thing works together. So this thing is able to recognize pretty much any sequence. If you want to target your favorite gene, the only requirement for your favorite gene is that it has to have this particular sequence. So N means any base. So it really just needs to have two G's in a row. So almost every gene somewhere has two G's in a row. So this can target almost everything, although not everything, and some people are working on that. But if you want to engineer something to your favorite gene, you'll be able to work on the system and it will find your gene. All we need to do is figure out the sequence here. So we know the sequence of a gene that you might be interested in, the DNA sequence of it. We build an RNA that's complementary to it, that matches that, as long as it also includes this little region. And this will drag this whole complex over to your gene of interest. So what is Cas9? So Cas9 is an endonuclease. So a nuclease is something that cuts nucleic acids. Endo means it does it in the middle. So exonuclease would be on the edges. Endo just means in the middle. So literally, it just cuts DNA in the middle. But that's important. And so if you imagine, here's your target DNA. We've got two strands. What's going to happen is the RNA that you created here is going to be complementary to this. So these are going to form base pairs. So it can recognize this. There's that specific little site called the PAM site that was at NGG. And that's a signal for this little complex to just cut the DNA right there. So that DNA that we targeted is now cut. Both strands of the DNA are cut. Okay. are lots of different ways that people have shown Cas9 and the RNA, and I've shown you a whole bunch of them just so you become familiar. Basically, there's a big blob with a line in it. The big blob is the protein Cas9, the line in it is the RNA. So it's going to cut the DNA. Great. Now it gets interesting depending on what happens next. And I also just wanted to mention that the other thing about this is, and you'll see this in a moment, is that these are all customizable. So this is going to be customizable to the target. So it goes to a particular gene that you're interested in and not a different gene. The Cas9, we can customize the protein and the function. Maybe we don't want it to cut the DNA. Maybe we want it to do something else. And as I mentioned, once you cut the DNA, that's a sign for the cell that this is dangerous. And the cell has lots of DNA damage repair methods where it's going to just try to fix that. If it sees a broken chromosome, it will try to fix it one way or another. So the most common way that happens is literally those two parts. It's just like, well, it's broken. I'm just going to shove it back together. And sometimes that gets, I mean, it's cut here kind of precisely. The cell will try to repair it. Sometimes it repairs it exactly right. But more often, when you have a broken chromosome and you try to put it back together, it's not quite there. So it's very common that there'll be an extra base as part of the repair machinery. It'll screw it up a little bit. So an extra base will be added, or maybe one is missing, or maybe 10 are missing. So chromosomes are millions and millions and millions of base pairs long. Getting it precise is hard. And so it doesn't always do it right. But you can imagine that if our goal is similar to what we were doing before, we want to make a gene knockout, we want to make a gene inactive, this is a really great way of doing that because we can figure out which gene we're interested in. We know the DNA sequence of that gene. We can make an RNA that's complementary to it and just cut that gene, cut the DNA in that gene, wait until it's cut, and see if it repairs itself perfectly. If it doesn't, I'll get you in a moment, we might have created a small change that maybe inactivates the gene. So if you imagine, so the most common thing that happens, at least in the system I work in, is you get an extra A, an extra base A added. So now it's in the middle of your gene, in the middle of an exon, you have an extra A. That means that that's a frameshift mutation. Everything else is going to be wrong. So that will actually inactivate the gene.
Yeah. In terms of the efficiency of this system, does it normally affect both pairs,
So if you're diploid and you've got two chromosomes?
Yeah, exactly.
So in fact, it does. This is, and I'm not sure if this is in every single system that has been looked at, but one of the big happy surprises was when people started to use this as a way of engineering or editing things they were interested in, they said, wait a minute, I have no normal copy of my gene anymore. I've got both of them edited, both copies edited. Now the interesting thing is it doesn't always make something homozygous, so they don't often have the same editing. So you have to imagine this is your wild-type chromosome, and you look at both of the versions, both chromosomes, one of them might have a mistake, an insertion. One of them might have a deletion. So this will recognize the DNA on both of those chromosomes. It'll cut it, but the repair isn't always exactly the same.
Yep. Does the Cas9 protein cut exactly at the parent site? I just noticed that there's still the green three base pairs on the right side with the pan purple on the right. So
yeah, it doesn't exactly cut there. So it cuts near there, but from... And we don't really know the mechanism of it, but from all the people, because this is, at this point, millions of experiments have been done, and it's around here, but it's often not exactly here.
Okay.
So So it's not a very precise, it's not precise in that it'll cut in exactly one place. It's precise in that it'll target a gene and it'll cut, and then you need to do something. Okay?
If you want to do like CRISPR to modify RNA, do you just have to modify the Cas protein, or is it a completely different system?
Okay, so here's a great question. So if you don't want to target DNA, but you want to target RNA, what could you do? Well, you need a different enzyme, because this Cas9 is something that's going to recognize DNA and cut that. So if there's an enzyme that cuts RNA, and there are, you could engineer it with that. So these are good things to be thinking about. What could you use it for a little bit? Okay, so that's a very efficient thing. Let me just go through a couple of uses of this, and then on Wednesday we'll come back to the other thing that can happen with this framework. So one thing is, remember, you already made, went through all this laborious process to make this knockout. I just mentioned how much easier it is with CRISPR. It also means that people are starting to make knockout mutants in organisms that they didn't spend a whole lot of time on. So this is Drosophila. There's 80 years and hundreds of people who've worked out ways to activate genes or inactivate genes. And you can, this is a particular example where they inactivated a gene in different ways and the wing got smaller and smaller and smaller. But there are other organisms that we're also interested in, but no one spent as much time. You can actually use CRISPR, because it's so efficient, to change the colors of butterfly wings or other things that we didn't spend a whole lot of time engineering before. And then, as a last example of this, just to give you a kind of visual example, so it's been used in agriculture. So these are little spotted pigs. The gene that's required for making that pigmentation is called MITF. And these are actually one of the first reports of actually modifying animals. These little piglets are modified, so they no longer have the dark pigment. If you look at how they're modified, so piglet number one, if you look, actually has two different, so it has both of the chromosomes were affected, but they were different changes. And then piglet two has the same change. These changes in the DNA, we did changes in the RNA and the changes in the protein, and this is a measurement of the protein. Neither one of these piglets makes the protein because of these mutations. And so then they lose their little dark spots. Okay, so we'll get into the other things for CRISPR, and then I'll also figure out which applications you guys chose.